Thank you very much, Minister, for your very kind introduction. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I regard it as a pleasure to have the opportunity to speak to you today at this meeting, particularly as the two leading conveners of this conference are extremely good friends of mine. In July 1924, Tehran woke up to the exciting news that the famous Saqqa-khaneh, or religiously endowed drinking water fountain, had performed miracles. Predictably, there were different versions to the story. First, the word went round that the Saqqa-khaneh had made a blind man see. Then it was said that either following the incident or independently, a Babi had tried to poison the water in the Saqqa-khaneh, and by a miracle, his or her hand had got stuck to the window. The most widespread story was that a Babi Baha'i girl had tried to poison the Saqqa-khaneh water and had suddenly gone blind. Babi pogroms were familiar incidents in various towns and cities of Iran since the rise of the Bab himself. The last major anti-Babi pogroms had been organized in Yazd and Isfahan in 1903, leaving more than 140 dead and many wounded and homeless. The more general whipping up of religious prejudices for political reasons was a well-known instrument for opposing a minister or a government policy, whether in the famous tobacco rebellion of 1891-92 or in the last well-known, less well-known campaigns against Belgian customs officers in Tehran and Tabriz in the early 1900s. Babism was a particularly soft target, and so many leaders and activists of the Constitutional Revolution were regularly described by their opponents as Babis in order to delegitimize them and their ideas. To briefly describe the context to this story, the Saqqa-khaneh incident occurred right in the middle of an increasingly bitter power struggle which had been going on for almost 2.5 years, virtually since the coup d'etat of February 1921, which had been led by Reza Khan and Sayed Zia, but quickly taken over by Reza Khan himself, who as Minister of War and Army Chief had acquired a considerable amount of dictatorial powers. The rising dictatorship was the cost of the failure of the Constitutional Revolution to establish a normal constitutional government, and instead growing chaos became the norm between 1909, the year of the capture of Tehran by the Constitutionalists, and 1921, when the coup took place. Reza Khan quickly managed to put down provincial unrest and tribal rebellion, but the policies of conflict and chaos did not come to an end in the cities, and power struggle was rife both in the parliament and through the press. Street crowds still gathered from time to time, and the press were frequently licentious, though less often than before. The forced majlis ended in 1923, when Reza Khan was not yet prime minister, but in the ensuing elections, pro-Reza Khan candidates gained the majority, and this heralded his rise to premiership. Still, it took a short while for Mushir ud-Dowla's cabinet to fall, Qawam ud-Saltaneh, Reza Khan's serious rival, to be chased out of the country, and Ahmad Shah to go on a trip to Europe from which he would never return. Having hit three targets with one blow, Reza Khan became prime minister late in October 1923 and began to mobilize his military and civilian forces for the final bid. He was popular among both the higher civil service and especially the army, and a good many modern nationalists were seeing him as the savior the country needed for stability and modernization. But he did not quite enjoy popular support. Indeed, Sayyid Hassan Mudarris, the erstwhile majority leader and parliamentary kingmaker, and now leader of the opposition, was more popular than him among the urban crowd, including and particularly the bazaar. Reza Khan's supporters, led by the Tajaddud or modernists, and socialist factions of the Majlis thought of a plan to change the constitution from monarchy to republic with the inevitable result that Reza Khan would become president and dictate. Whether at that stage his stage managers were thinking of this as the first step towards the establishment of the Pahlavi monarchy is difficult to know, although with hindsight, it is not unlikely that they had such a prospect in mind. The opposition, at any rate, was certain that that was the ultimate goal, and poet laureate Bahar pronounced it in a couple of political poems which he wrote at the time. He said, for example, in one of them, در پرده جمهوری کوبت در شاهی ما بی خبر و دشمن تما زرنگ است. In the name of republic, he is banging on the door of monarchy. We are naive and the greedy enemy is canny. The Republican campaign got quickly underway. Being sure of their parliamentary majority, the leading campaigners were in a hurry to make it to 21st of March 1924, Nowruz 1303, so that rather than Mohammad Hassan Mirza, the heir designate and regent, Reza Khan would, as president, take the salute at the Nowruz ceremony. They would have had their way had they not been in such a hurry and had Mudarris not used his hand as astutely. On the day that the issue was due to be debated in the parliament, the campaigners had sent a rented crowd to the Majlis gates where Reza Khan himself arrived to be present in the proceedings. The opposition supporters, however, outnumbered and drowned the voice of the government crowd and shouted slogans against Reza Khan on his arrival at the Majlis gate. Having been unpleasantly surprised, he angrily ordered the Majlis guard to attack the crowd and personally joined the combat. Meanwhile, the feelings were running high in the Majlis lobby before the House was formally called into session, with Mudarris using his brilliant rhetorical powers to defend what he described as the blood of the martyrs of the Constitutional Revolution. At this point, an emotional Reza Khan campaigner lost his cool and struck the respectable Mujtahid and leader of opposition in the face. The news having got out, it enhanced the number and intensified the anger of Mudarris supporters at the Majlis gates who were busy fighting the guard. This led to considerable bloodshed and left many wounded. The news angered the Majlis speaker, the moderate and popular Mirza Hossein Khan, Mu'taminul Mulk, who chastised Reza Khan for having ordered the Majlis guard, who were formerly under his own command, to attack the crowd outside. Thus, the leading figures of both sides felt that it was not at all opportune to call the Majlis into session. The campaign collapsed and Reza Khan resigned in anger, although the Majlis called him back to office shortly afterwards. This was the immediate background in March 1924 to the Saqqa-khaneh incident, which took place in July of the same year. However, 2 weeks before it, the young and fiery poet and journalist Mohammad Reza Mirzadeh Ishqi had been killed in broad daylight by two men who were believed to be police agents. Ishqi had gone overboard, publishing in his newspaper, Qarnevi Storm, poems and dramatic pieces about the rise and fall of the campaign for Republic, calling it a British conspiracy, and attacking and insulting Reza Khan personally, although he had stopped short of actually mentioning his name. However, his murder led to a strong public reaction. The matter was debated in Parliament, and in particular, poet laureate Bahar, a leading opposition spokesman, delivered a challenging speech in formal session. Not only that, the editors of 12 opposition newspapers declared that their lives were in danger and took bast or sanctuary in the Majlis. It was in this atmosphere that a certain amount of anti-Babi Baha'i campaign was led through the press, apparently preparing the ground for the great drama. As soon as the news of the Saqqa-khaneh's miracles were out, the city lights were turned on, the common people were jubilant, and they were organized as well as spontaneous demonstrations in and around the Saqqa-khaneh Ashikhadi district, as well as through the bazaar not too far from it. The first couple of days went eventless, except for the demonstrations and that sort of thing. But the slogans being shouted by shroud-wearing demonstrators became increasingly menacing. The crowds at the Saqqa-khaneh Haji, the crowds at the Agha Sheikh Haji junction were shouting, Saqqa-khaneh chi karde, chesh dokhtara ro ku karde. Man nemiduni chi karde, chesh dokhtara ro ku karde. What's the Saqqa-khaneh done? It's blinded the girl. Don't you know what it's done? It's blinded the girl. The crowd following it were shouting, چهارراه عاشق هادی از معجزه ابوالفضل کور شده چشم بابی. At Agha Sheikh Haji junction, by the miracle of ابوالفضل, the Babi's been blinded. Down in the bazaar, a shroud-wearing crowd was moving through its labyrinthine team chairs, shouting obscene slogans. A colossus of a man turning a long stick around his head was shouting, "In sautur qastabi," and the crowd following him shouted, "Dar zan babi." Then he shouted, "In deylam tuntabi." The crowd shouted to return the slogan, "Dar zan babi." It is very difficult indeed to translate these words into familiar English, other than saying that it's beginning to become comical. Now, other than saying that they are obscene sexual insults to the Babi's wife. Meanwhile, a number of sick and disabled people had rushed to the Saqqa-khaneh to seek healing and cure. On the other hand, the news of the excitement, having reached the expatriate community, Major Robert Imrie, American vice consul and keen amateur photographer, accompanied by a friend, went to the scene to take pictures, apparently for the National Geographic. The crowd were both excited and suspicious to see these blue-eyed men in their frock coats and top hats trying to set up their camera to take pictures. At first, they were told to remove the camera, and after it was moved around twice, a couple of men came forward trying to stop them by throwing their coats over the camera. The major lost his cool and began to shout at the crowd, whereupon the crowd responded by abusing him and rushing to attack him and his companion. The two men, having smelled danger, they boarded the carriage and asked the driver to move on. The carriers crossed the Agha Sheikh Haji junction into Estakhr Street. Someone shouted, "These are the Babis who tried to poison the Saqqa-khaneh's water." Whereupon the mob began to chase the carriers while shouting, wielding sticks, and throwing stones. A few of them then caught up with the carriers and pulled the driver down. A soldier who happened to be around jumped into the driver's seat, turned the carriage around, and crossed the Hasanabad junction towards the Tupkhane or Artillery Square. By the time the carriage reached the gates of Maidan-e-Mashq or Drill Square, where a few soldiers were standing, the mob managed to stop the carriage and attack the two men. The major trying to defend himself with a sharp staff. According to pro-government sources, they were then struck down by the mob, while the opposition sources maintained that it was the soldiers who hit the men with their bayonets. At any rate, the police and other security men arrived from the nearby police headquarters and took the wounded men to the police general hospital, followed by the crowd and soldiers. Both were still alive on arrival, but the major died of further blows afterwards at the hospital, by the mob, according to the government, by soldiers, according to the opposition. The government responded swiftly and with vigor. Martial law was declared. A couple of hundred people were arrested, and some of them were executed or jailed following quick military trials. Profuse apologies were sent by the foreign ministry to the American legation, and through it, the American government. an indemnity of $60,000 was approved to be paid to the victim's family. A further $110,000 was due to be paid for the cost of the boat that would carry the major's body back to America. But the U.S. government suggested the money be paid into a fund to enable a few Iranian students to study in their country. Not only the government, but also the opposition, not least Mudarris himself, expressed deep regret at the incident. But at the same time, theories, innuendos, and jibes began to circulate regarding the hands behind the incident. The opposition claimed that it was a conspiracy to enable the government to declare martial law, impose censorship, arrest or silence some of their political opponents in the process, and point the finger of accusation against the opposition as backward-looking obscurantists, especially in the Western eyes. The government and its supporters did exactly that and held the opposition responsible for both the riots and murder and their own measures to quell the disturbance. It is true that the government ultimately benefited by the incident, but the trend of events makes it clear that the government cannot have instigated it. Indeed, one of the Crown's slogans, "In Babi bi ghairat ya ghishode ba millat," this unprincipled Babi has rebelled against the people, which pointed at one particular person, makes it clear that its target was Reza Khan himself. On the other hand, the incident was clearly not in the interest of the opposition, and in any case, both before and after this event, they showed that they were much more of a parliamentary than an unruly street opposition. However, the opposition to Reza Khan and republicanism was not confined only to them and included the still considerable, though dwindling conservative forces led by the royal court and a number of leading ulama of Tehran. Of these, Sayyid Muhammad Imam Jum'a and his brother Sayyid Jawad Zahirul Islam, who were related to the royal family, as well as Haj Agha Jamal Isfahani and Sheikh Muhammad Khalisi Zadeh, were some of the most influential. Indeed, 4 months before, during the struggle for and against the declaration of republic, Khalisi Zadeh had led a crowd to the majlis where scuffles had broken out between him and some leading pro-Reza Khan deputies. In a letter from the Prince Regent to his brother Ahmad Shah in Europe, only parts of which have survived, he claimed that it was the soldiers, not the people, who had killed Imri in the hospital. But it is clear from the tone that he sympathized with the rioters, although he implied that Reza Khan was responsible for the whole sorry affair. Therefore, and on balance, the royal court and their conservative allies look most likely to have instigated the anti-Babi riots. In the following October, the opposition's move against Reza Khan by encouraging Sheikh Khaz'al to lead an uprising did not succeed. As is well known, the power struggles came to an end in October 1925 with the fall of the Qajars and accession of Reza Shah. That, however, was far from the end of the affair in Iranian political folklore. The conspiracy legend, which was elaborated and widely believed for decades, indeed until one or two decades ago, was that the whole thing had been organized by Britain, by Inglisha, in order to stop the Americans from getting a concession for North Iranian oil. It was, however, somehow overlooked that for this legend to be true, the American vice consul must have been a British agent agreeing to let himself be martyred on His Majesty's service.